All right, welcome back. Now, in the last video, we set up a basic blueprint that we can use to show off dynamic material instances, and now we are ready to start constructing the graph for it. Before we do that, though, you can see I have my random chair blueprint here in the content browser. This is what we created in the last video. I'm just going to drag that right out into the scene, and I'll tap the E key and rotate it so that it is, well, kind of facing the player start. We'll also kind of face it into the light as well so that we can really make out the change in the material. Okay, with that done, we can now edit the graph for this. I'm going to do this by jumping over to the Details panel, and you'll see there's a tiny blue hyperlink over here that we can click on. It said Edit Random Chair. When I click on that, it opens up our graph. Now, there are two parts to making a dynamic material instance. The first part is actually specifying within your blueprint that you want the material that is currently applied to this object to be dynamic, and then you will set up whatever behavior you want to make that material change in your event graph. So the first part of that takes place in the construction script. Here in the construction script, we will determine what material we're going to be using and then make it dynamic, which is extremely easy to do. I'm going to bring in our static mesh, which I suppose if I wanted to be all nice and concise about everything, I could rename. It's very easy to do. We can jump over to the components mode. And here you can see my static mesh right up here at the top. We can just right click on this, choose rename, and I'll just call this chair. So that when I jump back over to the graph, you'll see that the static mesh is now called chair. I'll drag this into the graph and choose get, because we want to get some information from this. Specifically, we want to get its material and make a dynamic version of it. Watch how easy this is. If I drag a wire here out into open space and let go, let's say we don't know what node we need, we just kind of know what we want to do, which is to make a dynamic material. So let's just type in dynamic. And right there at the top, you see create dynamic material instance. All we need to do is take the construction script and connect it up. And we are essentially done at this point. This node will automatically grab the material that's been applied to the chair at element index 0, or basically the first material that's been applied, and it'll create a dynamic version of that where we can talk to all of those parameters that are in the material, such as the parameter named color seats that we looked at in the last video. Now, there's one more thing I want to do that'll make our job a whole lot easier over in the event graph, and that is to take this dynamic material and put it into a variable so that we can call it by name and talk to it in our event graph. So this is also very easy. I'm just going to right click on the return value output pin and choose promote to variable. That automatically creates the exact type of variable I need. It's already set up and connected. It's just waiting for me to type in a name. So we will call this dynamic material. We're done. So I'll compile and I'll click save just to be on the safe side. And then over in the event graph, we can start creating the system by which we will change color. And we're going to start very simple, and then we'll add some randomization. So let's begin by selecting the actual box that surrounds the chair. This is going to be kind of like a trigger volume. When the player enters this, we're going to change the color of the chair cushions. So with the box one selected, I'll just simply right-click here in the graph, and you'll see Add Event for Box 1. We'll expand that. We'll expand Collision, and choose Add On Component Begin Overlap, like so. Super easy. Next, we want to talk to that material parameter that affects the seat color. And it was actually called color seats. To do that, we need to get our reference to the dynamic material, that variable that we created earlier. I'm going to hold down the control key and drag this into the graph. That automatically creates a getter or a get version of this variable because we know we want to get some information from it. We will drag a wire out. And let's just choose set vector parameter value. Now, all we need to do is specify the name of the property we want to control. And we looked that up in the last video, but if you need a quick refresher, we can do that right here in the components mode. So let's click on the components tab. We'll select our chair. And if we double click on the static mesh, so you'll see here in the static mesh group, we can double click that, and that opens up the static mesh editor. And at the very top, you can actually see the material. We can double click that. And in this way, it's actually very easy for you to step through all of the different references that make up your object. And again, here's the color seats vector parameter that is driving the color of our chair seat or the actual cushion. So we'll jump back to our blueprints and return to the graph tab. I'll select my set vector parameter value node, and we will set the parameter name to color seats, like so. Now for starters, we're not going to worry about randomization. We're just going to set this to a value of our choice. So currently, the seats are orange. So let's set something to way on the opposite end of the spectrum. The opposite would be something like blue. Let's go with green. I don't know why. I just want to see a green chair. We'll saturate it. Now all we need to do is connect this up. So when we detect an overlap with that box component, we are going to change the value within color seats to green. That's exactly what this network says. So let's go ahead and compile. We'll click save. I'm going to slide this off the view so I can bring it back later. And then let's just give this a quick play. Oh, and it looks like it already triggered. So I think my player start might be colliding with that box. And actually, you can see that it is. If I look down from above, it's just starting to encroach. So let's move the player start back, or we could take the chair and actually slide it away. Just put a little bit of space in between them. And now when we play again, you'll see that the chair is orange. And as we get close, it changes color to green. That's exactly what we wanted to see happen. So with the test successful, let's now augment our graph just slightly so that we're creating a random value. Now we can do that in a few different ways, but if you grab the color input or the color value input here, which is currently a linear color, if I drag out and type in random, you notice we don't get any results. So there's no random color node, and there won't always be a node for each and every little thing that you want to do by default. The trick, though, is thinking back to what we talked about in the materials lessons, where we discussed that every color is really just a collection of numbers. We have numbers for red and for green and for blue. So what we're going to do is choose three random colors between 0 and 1, or I'm sorry, three random numbers between 0 and 1, and we'll use those to make a color. So let's just right-click here in the graph, and I'll type random. And what we want is a random float from within a range. We'll leave our minimum at 0 and set our maximum to 1. And I'm going to duplicate this three separate times because we want three random numbers, one for red, one for green, and one for blue. I'll grab the return value from the first one, drag a wire out, and we're going to use this to literally make a color. So we can click Make Color, like so. Plug this random into green. Plug this value into blue, and there we go. We have just constructed a color. We can take the result, plug it into our value, and we are done. So let's go ahead and compile, save, and give this a quick test. Oh, this time we get kind of a blue cyan color. Back out of the box, come back in, and now we get green. Move away, come back in, and now we get pink. So each time we enter the box, we're getting a different random color. To show this off, I'm going to try to make the most of my screen space here. We're going to slide the viewport over so I can see like so. Let's do this a different way. I'm going to take my event graph, and I'm going to pull off the actual tab for the graph itself. We'll get the rest of the editor out of the way, and I'll hit the Windows key and tap the right arrow, and that'll just slap that here on one side of the view. And then let's take the viewport. This is just fun to show you we can do cool stuff with the interface. We'll actually rip off the viewport, hold down the Windows key and hit Windows left, and now I have a view on one side and I have my graph on the other. So we'll hit Alt-P to start playing, and now whenever I enter that box, you can actually see the code firing and see the color change at the same time. So that is a quick look at making a dynamic material instance. It's an instance version of the material that has parameters that can change at runtime or during gameplay. And again, there's a lot of different ways to apply this. This is a very simple example. And as you get deeper into Unreal Engine 4, I'm sure you'll think of a lot of different ways that you can change your materials during gameplay. But that's going to wrap things up for this video. Thanks a lot.